Good afternoon, good evening, good morning. Greetings from Warsaw, Poland. It is our great honor to welcome so many art professionals and changemakers from around the world joining today's edition of The Art of Mindfulness. LUAN, international curator of experiences that connect beauty, truth and ethical reflection, and the Global Leaders Program, growth platform for impact-focused arts entrepreneurs worldwide, joined forces to co-present The Art of Mindfulness. The Art of Mindfulness brings inspiring voices from the intersection of art, ethics, and mindfulness into the lives of individuals on all continents. In a time marked by increasing complexities, The Art of Mindfulness offers an interactive platform to find peace, meaning, and collective conscience through diverse artistic practices. Whether by cultivating mindfulness techniques in life or reconnecting with our creative selves, this series is designed to impact. The Global Leaders Program offers an Ivy League curated executive graduate certificate in social entrepreneurship and cultural agency. Each year, 50 music professionals distinguished by proven accomplishments and a persevering commitment to create change become part of an international cohort. Led in partnership with 9 top universities, among them Harvard, Duke, Georgetown, NYU and McGill, the Global Leaders Program's faculty includes Nobel Prize receivers, Grammy winners and TED presenters. Together, they work with and support cohort members throughout a 9-month journey that combines online and in-person courses and retreats, and features on-the-ground fieldwork in more than 40 countries. Today's session is co-hosted by LUAN Museo Emocional.
How many times have we been told that it's wrong to feel? How many times have you walked and ignored the landscape? It's time to stop and think about what we can do today to change tomorrow. To realize that as long as the sun goes down and comes out again, there is an opportunity to make a change. Because if we can dream of a better world, we can create it. Let's explore beyond what we can see at a glance. Let's make our inspiration, imagination, and creativity the main elements of the world we want. Let's analyze our decisions and discover what drives us to go in a deep state of reflection that provides us with tools to create good day by day. May the freedom to play and the empowerment of our individual and collective ethics guide the way. Feel, believe, and create. The change we're waiting for depends on us. LUAN, Emotional Museum.
Before introducing today's distinguished speakers, I would like to share brief housekeeping requests to help make today's session more interactive and engaging for all of you who have joined. At the bottom of the screen, you will see a control panel with the chat. Please go over now and write your name, country of residence, and your organization. In the control panel, you will also find a questions section. You are encouraged to engage directly with our panelists by posing a question for them in the questions box. Please submit your questions as early as possible in the session, as there will be a limit to how many can be answered. Finally, at the end of today's session, you will be prompted to complete a brief survey that will appear on your screens. We kindly ask that you share constructive feedback or suggestions for future sessions as we continue to evolve this growing series to address topics and challenges of relevance to all of you working in this sector around the world. And with that, let's get started.
Hi, everyone. How are you? My name is Marion from LUAN Museo Emocional. Well, first of all, I want to thank you all so much for being here today with us. It's truly, truly a pleasure for me to introduce you today to our speaker, Yatan Blumenthal. Yatan is not only an amazing person, but he works as a digital consultant and emotional intelligence and mindful leadership trainer. He truly believes that mindfulness tools serve to explore and manage our own experience, and that these are essential to furthering us as human beings and organizations. He has trained over 100 startups and consulted corporations on innovation and startup relation matters in Europe, Asia, and Latin America. In the past, he has worked as COO, country manager, and accelerator chief, as well as he has also founded Hardware.com, the first hardware startup accelerator in mainland Europe. I'm so excited for this experience today. I invite everyone to let loose, to feel, to play, to have fun. This will be an introspective, curious, and very self-reflecting experience. I invite everyone to deeply connect with their emotions and let Yatan work his magic and guide us through this wonderful and compassionate experience. Yatan, please welcome. We are so happy to have you here with us.
Hello, Marion. Hello, everybody. I'm really happy to be here with you. Excited to have so many people here, wow, from all over the world. So thank you so much to LUAN and Global Leaders Program for giving me the stage today. And I would like to then start off by sharing my screen. All right, so yes, I am Yatan, and thank you for the intro. I don't think I need to say any more about that. And today I'm going to just guide you through a little experience that I designed. And just to remind you that this is going to be a bit of an emotional experience, and I invite you to put whatever, you know, like phone or anything like that away so you can be present with us. This is being recorded, but not the chat part. So you can be as open there as you want, and I mean in general. And to take care of yourself, you know? So if something gets too uncomfortable, or you don't want to say something, or you don't want to participate, feel free to do that. This is, everybody goes at their own pace. And to get started, I'd like to just get a little reading on the room by having you type in something on menti.com, which is a little visualization tool. Namely, the question, answer to the question, how are you feeling now? So I'd like to ask you to go to menti.com and type in the code 19662. Somebody typed in 119962. That's funny. Bothered, happy emoticons. I didn't actually know you could do those. At peace. Tired. Happy seems to be the highest score. That's, I'm very glad to hear that. But also grateful, anxious, neutral. In peace. Tired. Yeah, so there are people from all over the world joining in for this. So I saw them. It's already like really excited. What a crowd. So I'm aware that you must, yeah, you could be early in the morning here. It's 11 a.m. Some people, it's maybe already tomorrow even. And I just do this exercise to have a little reading so we can recognize it's okay to feel whichever way you're feeling. And with that, we can begin our session as the last things come in. And then we will look at this a little bit later again. Thank you for putting in how you're feeling. I'm very grateful to be here and happy. So I resonate with that. So you're seeing a black screen. That's on purpose. So it's not a mistake. And it's just to get started I want to give a little bit of like a recognition of the situation that we're going through nowadays with the pandemic. A lot of death is around, or a lot of things have become more visible. They were there all along, but maybe we didn't see them because so many other things were going on, and we have had the curse, but also the opportunity of maybe having a bit more time or more less going on, so we can actually see more. And I believe that we need support and the ability to sit compassionately and talk about our own particular experiences with hardship, with racism, with death, alienation. And we need help developing the capacity to listen to different stories of others with compassion. And this is what this little session is going to be about, which is to creating space inside ourselves to recognize the contradictions that we have, for those to dissolve or to be able to change. And with that, a little recognition of also what's been happening in the US, most visibly, which is the protests about systemic racism and about violence that has been going on there, which is of course not just in the US. This is something that happens everywhere. I myself am in Colombia at the moment. Here it's just as present, but it's more disguised, I guess, because it can live under other myths. Like here in Colombia, for example, we have the myth of everybody being mixed. So if everybody's mixed, like I'm mixed and most people are mixed, how can you be racist? But of course, that's not the reality. That's just a myth to hide ourselves from what we don't want to look at. And with that, I'd like to invite you to our moment to arrive, which is just a tiny micro meditation. I'd like to invite you to lower your gaze, sit in a way that is both alert and comfortable for you, or close your eyes. And just take a moment to see where you're at, how you're feeling now, and just take 3 deep breaths. And just consider, maybe what does this topic mean to you? Or how would you like to show up? Or is there maybe anything else that you can let go that happened just before this or that you were thinking about? Ask you to come back and open your eyes if you haven't already done so. And now to our first exercise. So I'm going to ask you to take a look at 2 different pictures. And actually, this might be a good opportunity for you to get a pen and paper or something to write. We're going to ask you a couple of times to write some things down that you're noticing. So I'll just give you a minute to find something. It's actually fun seeing people looking for something to write. Yes. So thank you for, for those who are asking. The picture is going to come in a second. I was just waiting for people to have something to write. So the picture is coming next, and what I'm going to ask you to do is, this is one of the pictures. So what I want to ask you is to get closer to your computer and kind of try to like zoom in with your eye on each of the pictures that you see on each of these people. And try to just be neutral and see like, what are opinions I might have about this person? Or does it spark a feeling, or does it spark an emotion? And just take maybe 10 seconds for each person, and then look, what is my reaction to this person, and write this down, or make a mental note, whatever is best for you. So here was also going into, does it evoke an emotion from their point, you know, from their facial expression, from the way they look, from their gender, from their clothing. And now I'll show you another picture and I'll ask you to do the same exercise. Okay, thank you. So why did I show you these two pictures? There are actually two pictures that came up when you Google race or ethnicity. The second one, I think, was like from a book that was about the races of the Far East. And it was something like that. So it's a depiction of how probably a European sees the different people in Asia. And the reason why I showed you this is because of the concept of being a racialized body or a sexualized body. So we can recognize emotions in others that is wired in us, but there is a layer which is we put properties or even emotions or all kinds of things on people for the way they look or for the way they, if they are, well, have a skin color in a certain way, their face looks a certain way, their hair, or whether it's their gender. And that is the concept of racialized bodies, which are so that there is a meaning that is actually not there that we project onto people and onto ourselves as well, which is from a belief system that we learn in school, you know, through culture, through TV, which I think is really worthwhile knowing more about. So now, for this next exercise, now that we took a time to look at other faces, I would like to ask you to just take a moment to reflect about you. What is it what is the impact, or here are the prompts, what does it mean to you to have been racialized the way you are? Whichever way that is. What does it mean for you in your standing in the world? What does it mean in your self-image or in the way you have been treated? Can go either way, you know, positive, negative, neutral. And how might it benefit you and the world if you understood that better? I'll give you 3 minutes to just write it down in your notebook or in the chat.
Wow, we have so many amazing comments. Mainly, you know, people saying that it makes them more resilient. Being dominated or conditioned by, you know, like a cultural system, sad, an opportunity to create new change. Wow, these comments are wonderful. Advantages and disadvantages to being racialized, injustice, isolated and oppressed. Frustrating, offended, challenged.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's really interesting what you're saying. Thank you for sharing so much. It has a lot of weight in different ways. Oh, for some it's benefited, for some it's not, but it's, I think it's a general consent that it's not really a fair thing, you know, that whatever you look like has so much weight, means so much about who you are from the views of others. And yeah, it's because it suggests that we cannot understand others without looking at them. You know, like that has all this weight that it actually shouldn't have. But it's important to understand that this is a process that is constantly going on with all of us, and it's worthwhile looking at it, you know, from. To see how one can act, or how can one benefit their own community and other communities. So thank you so much for sharing. So see, yeah, some say marginalized, judged. Says I love my race and how I have been raised.
People also have pointed a lot that it's really unfair, and it's an opportunity to make change, no? That right now with everything, with the global movement that's happening around the world, it's, you know, the perfect timing to start making people more aware of this.
Yeah. Exactly. And I wanted to start with this because not as like a, just to be aware of it. We're gonna go into like, what is it that we can actually do with this awareness? So thank you for sharing. There's a lot of good stuff here. So I'm looking forward to reading it again in a little bit. So chat share, we already did it. No need for that. And then I really like this quote by Ta-Nehisi Coates, who says, race is the child of racism, not its father. So to go about this belief of this racialized body and these assumptions about the other people is what creates racism, not the other way around. And with that, I would like to invite you to our second meditation exercise, which is a body scan. And we're just gonna go a little bit into checking different types, parts of our body, just to get a bit of more awareness for our next exercise. So with that, I invite you to once again, get in a comfortable position or posture, and which where you can also be alert. And then close your eyes or lower your gaze. And I will be guiding you to bring your attention to different parts of your body with the intention to develop self-awareness. We will just notice our sensations at each point rather than trying to cultivate or induce any states. So let's start with the top of your head, your scalp. Notice any sensations or lack of sensations. And now bring your awareness down to your face, your forehead, the muscles around your eyes, cheeks, jaw, lips, tongue. Move your attention to the front of your neck and then to the back of your neck. There's no need to change your experience. The purpose is not to relax or release tension. Simply notice what is. And now, move your attention to your shoulders, becoming aware of your upper arms, your lower arms, your hands. What sensations do you notice? You may notice sensations such as heat or cold, weight or lightness, moisture or dryness, tingling, pulsing, or maybe throbbing. And now bring attention to your upper back and down to your lower back. Next, to the front of your body, your chest, and your stomach. Noticing the sensations of the breath, maybe the beating of your heart, or anything else. And sensing through the lower part of your body, notice your hips and seat. Now moving through one leg at a time, through your thighs, knees, shins, calves, ankles, tops and bottoms of your feet, all the way to your toes. And then bring your attention to your entire body, from the top of your head to your feet. Notice the whole body and notice your breath. What is it like to be sitting here right now? And now let's explore what happens when we make a slight physical movement. Bring your attention to your face and try raising the edges of your mouth slightly, resulting in you having a half smile. Notice any changes in how you feel. And if you'd like, bring someone to mind that you care about and imagining them well and happy, smiling at you. What do you experience? If feelings of satisfaction or happiness arise, where in your body do these feelings manifest? And now, bring your attention back to your breath, breathing in and breathing out. And let's just settle the mind there for a moment, noticing what it's like to be breathing, just being curious, open, noticing. And when you're ready, I invite you to fully open your eyes and return with your attention to the room. Right, so I would like to ask you to consider the exercise not quite done, the body scan. And I'm going to play you an audio clip from an author that I really admire. And I would like you to take the time to, or put the attention on what you're feeling, what comes up for you when you listen to this audio clip.
In June 1984, 21 years after Dr. King bellowed the words I just spoke, across the National Mall in Washington, D.C., and dropped his hope-drenched dream into our collective consciousness, I was perhaps the most hopeful 16-year-old girl in all of Hampton, Virginia. Because despite a childhood that had often been a painful one, I'd reached that moment when the dreams that had gotten me through it were actually starting to come true. College, my passport to freedom, was just around the corner. And for the very first time, I was in love. His name was Jake. Yes, at that moment, there was more right than wrong in my world. Which is why what Jake told me just days before I was to leave Hampton for a summer university course hit me so hard. "My dad just kicked me out of the house," Jake told me over the phone. "He did what? Why?" I said this, knowing what would come next. "You know why. I told you how he is. It's because of us. He said no son of his is going to be dating some black girl." Oh, did I fail to mention that Jake and I had been raised in a world in which he was considered white and I black? Micro-reflection. Had you already made assumptions about Jake's race? Was the question forming in your mind? Either way, congratulate yourself. You've just brought awareness to some of the ways that your brain does race. For instance, the way that you make race-based assumptions and fill in the blanks as you go when reading stories, names, resumes, and so on. Jake had used the word black when he might have used some other. I knew that his father's way was something he was actively resisting. We were on the same side in this, and that meant everything. But even with Jake's support, I still remember the pain that gripped me that afternoon on hearing that my race, this category created by others that did not and could not capture much of who I really was, had made me unacceptable to my true love's family. My race had made me the other. I had known that this might happen when we started dating, of course, but that did not make it any less devastating. And I remember learning something more, that my being a black girl had not only made me unacceptable to Jake's working-class Virginia family, but had made me so unacceptable that they were willing to throw their own reportedly beloved son out of their home and onto the streets like garbage. It hit me hard that this notion that they had about me, or more accurately about people supposedly like me, as they had never actually met me, had made me so unacceptable that they were willing to hurt their own son, and thereby themselves, and all to teach him, me, and anyone around us a multifaceted lesson.
Yes, so that was a story about about Rhonda McGee that she experienced in her young years. And now I'd like to ask you, what happened to you when you listened to that story? What was your reaction? Did you feel anything in your body, emotions? Where did you feel those? And I'd like to invite you to share it again in the chat.
Wow, anger and sadness, of course. I bend my head forward with sadness, sense of injustice, anger, melancholy, sympathy. I feel so sad. Angry. Infuriated. Hardened stomach. I felt sad. I can relate with her. Sad and angry. Confused. Sense of injustice. Empathy and familiarity. Hurt and anger. I have felt that type of rejection, but on a base of gender and sexuality instead. Awakened. Sad and discomforted. Very bad. Why does this happen? My question. We will go after that for the questions. It's an everywhere story, sadly. Discomfort. Sense of helplessness. Sad and angry. Lost. Disencouraged. Pity on my parents' narrow-mindedness. Sense of inhumane, sad, ignorance, lack of freedom, pity, outrage. How an idea can destroy a family. Pity at the ignorance and lack of sensibility. Disappointed. Anger. Confused. Reminded me of a similar relationship through Kenyan who left for the US. I was left sad, confused, and entering into a relationship with which has GBV, lost opportunity, sadness, lost time, disappointment, and depression at some point because of that. Thank you for sharing, everyone.
Yeah, thank you for sharing. Thank you for reading it, Marion. It's so this is what we call, what Rhonda McGee calls moment of racial discomfort. And such moments are common in a world shaped by racism. And it's important to consider in these kind of moments that you who is feeling this discomfort deserves kindness in this moment, and to also offer kindness to others impacted by this moment as well. So in this case, Jake and Rhonda, because it's the fact that this happens, and it's important that we learn to handle it with compassion, so we can also talk about it and not feel, you know, like oppressed by it in itself. Because it's a belief system that we just need to create space for to be able to actually talk about it, and then slowly disintegrate it, replace it with something more humane. And this as an argument, as a world in general, we don't fully acknowledge white supremacy as a system, as an ideology. And it's, even though it's very hidden in a lot of things, and people feel offended when they get spoken to, like white people. It's something that is there, and it's, if you look at it, it's actually quite obvious still, you know, which is why we did the exercise of the racialized bodies. What does it mean? What does society, what does the world say about who are you just because of how you look? And sadly, it's unchangeably, it's something that's still very, very, very present. And that's what makes me hopeful about the protests and all the things that are going on, that it gives us a possibility to actually look at it, which was before really just swept under the rug. Because denying it makes it live on, and recognizing it is the first step to being able to know how to handle it. So I snuck in this slide. I didn't show you before, just as like a pointer on how people feel emotions. So this is a research that was done in Sweden, I believe, but it started there and it was done in a lot of different places. And people were giving prompts or images, and they felt different. So they felt the emotions, and what you can see is the more yellow it gets, the stronger the emotion is, or the stronger the sensation, and the more blue it gets, it's the less. So why do I show you this? Because this shows that we all actually feel the emotions the same way, pretty much, or in very, very similar ways. It doesn't matter who you are, what your culture is or anything. It's a physical sensation. Emotions are actually physical. They're not mental. They are emotions that we have there. They happen in our body. And that's why something like a body scan is something that can be very, very powerful to just train. What am I feeling? Is there something that I maybe don't like, but which I am actually feeling? You know, I know I have had different situations in my life where I had to recognize with a bias I had myself, you know, that I wasn't aware of, because my belief system wasn't really supporting that bias, but the bias was still there because I had learned it nonetheless. So it's a good way to know. All right, and now I want to show you a quick video about the science, I guess, of in-group, out-group, which is like one of the things that leads to discrimination.
I've been researching this back in my laboratory, and here was my main question. When we interact with someone, does our brain function differ according to which group they're in? For every in-group we belong to, there's at least one group that we don't. And that division can be based on anything: race, or gender, or wealth, or religion.
We put 130 participants in the scanner. And here's what they saw: 6 hands on the screen, and the computer randomly picks one of these, and then that hand gets stabbed by a syringe needle. Now that activates the pain matrix, which is what comes online when you're in pain or you see someone else in pain. Now here's the trick. We now added a label to each hand: Jewish, Christian, Muslim, Hindu, atheist, Scientologist. And the question is, would they care as much when they see a member of their outgroup getting stabbed? So here's what we found. here's a subject, and when he watched a member of his in-group getting stabbed, there was a large neural response in this area of his brain. But when he watched a member of one of his out-groups get stabbed, there was essentially a flat line.
We scanned a range of volunteers, and there are individual differences, but the trend is clear.
A single word label is enough to change your brain's basic preconscious response to another person in pain. In other words, how much you care about them. Now, you might have opinions about religion and its historical divisiveness, but even atheists here care more about other atheists' hands getting stabbed than they do about other people. So it's not really about religion. It's about which team you're on.
Yeah, so this research for me was like, when I first read it, I was like, wow, because it tells us, or well, science shows us that it's actually very natural tendency of all human beings to discriminate those that are not in our in-group. And that in-group, as the researcher said, is very, very arbitrary, you know? So it can be not looking like me, not liking the same football team as me, not being the same, holding the same passport as me, you know? So it's impressive, and it's like, it's something to watch out for, I guess, because it's our natural tendency. So that's why I was like, for people to discriminate other people is more about training this away, or informing yourself about this, so you can correct for this tendency that we all have. So it's also helped me to be more compassionate with people that I can consider discriminating, including myself, because it's something that you can actually train, and why we need to broaden our in-groups in order to escape from this tendency that we all have. And that we're gonna go on. And then I just wanna show you just one more concept before we go into our next exercise, which is the final meditation, which is empathy. So empathy is defined as feeling what the other is feeling, but also being able to differentiate what is what I feel, how am I feeling, and how is the other person feeling. So being able to set a boundary between the two. When that goes wrong, let's say when we cannot tell the difference between what the other person is feeling and what I am feeling, this can lead to empathic distress, which is what happens with a lot of people who are working in healthcare, or working with the people who are oppressed or marginalized or suffering, that they can actually burn out because they're not able to differentiate between the two. So it's actually they're absorbing pain and suffering from a lot of people, which is not sustainable in a long-term way. And the way out of this is by training compassion, which is a strategy to overcome adverse experiences, which strengthens resilience. And that's why we're going to do the next exercise, which is a meditation on compassion. So once again, I would like to invite you to sit in a way that is comfortable and where you can be alert. And I invite you, before we get started, to think of a person or a group of people that you know or you know of who are in a challenging situation and who you feel moved to try to help. Could be a person in your personal life, in your professional life. could be a person or a team or a group of people that you don't know, but you have heard of. And I suggest picking a situation where a bit of courage may be needed. And when you have picked the person or group of people, you can say their name silently in your mind to just help focus your attention. So let's begin by taking a moment to collect our attention and just find that position that feels supported and balanced. You may want to bring some stability to the body by placing the feet flat on the floor and resting the hands on your thighs. And you can close your eyes or allow your gaze to rest downwards towards the ground. And I now invite you to turn your attention to your breath, sensing where in the body you can feel the breath moving. That may be the tips of the nostrils, the abdomen, or maybe a sense of the whole body breathing. And wherever you can feel the breath, allow your attention to rest there for just a few moments. And each time the mind wanders, just return your attention to the feeling of breathing. And let's now explore the first step of compassion: being attentive to the needs of others. Bring to mind the person you thought of and the challenging situation they are in. What are they experiencing right now? In their work, their physical or mental well-being, or their relationships? What emotions or thoughts might this person or these groups of people be experiencing. As you consider this person's experience, you can silently note them in your mind with a word or phrase like stress or challenging relationship. You might consider that people generally wish to be happy, safe, and respected. What basic human needs might be present for this person? And now, let's consider the second step: wishing the best for others. What would it feel like for you to wish the best for this person or this group of people? And to find this feeling, you might consider some of these phrases. May you be safe. May you be free from physical and mental harm. May you find fulfilling relationships. May you be happy. Inviting a feeling of wishing the best for this person, however feels natural to you. And now, let's explore the third step: sensing what will truly serve. I invite you to begin by simply dropping this question into your awareness and seeing what thoughts, feelings, or images arise. The question is, what would be of service? Recognizing that what will truly serve can look very different in each relationships. Perhaps what would serve is setting a boundary or speaking a challenging truth. Perhaps safety or support or reassurance, or simply being with this person as they have this life experience. What would be of service? What does the voice of courage ask of me? And there's no need to make a lot of effort, simply listening for where you feel moved. Checking in with yourself. At the level of the head, did any thoughts or words come up? In the body, were there any emotions, instincts, or impulses to act? And in the heart, did any emotions or values come up? Is there a word that could summarize what would truly be of service? And letting it all sink in gently and softening any needs to have the right answer. What came up may be a shift in your understanding or movement to act, or even the recognition that your feelings are unclear. Whatever came up, you can explore further over time. And now, let's move towards closing this practice by returning the attention to the breath, letting go of any thoughts, images, or emotions. Trusting that what's important from this reflection will still be there for you. With the inhale, feeling the body and mind, gaining energy and vitality. With the exhale, feeling the body and mind and letting go. Thank you for your attention. So a micro practice for this meditation is just asking what would be of service in any situation. And sometimes when the person is not with us or there's nothing we can do, what can be of service is just to wish them well. Here, just another reference about history when taught well shows us how to improve the world, but history when taught poorly falsely claims there's nothing to improve. But to be able to tell history, you know, correctly, sometimes it takes some courage to look into your past, into your country's past, into your own belief system, and that requires some compassion. And why do we do this? Because difficult roads lead to beautiful destinations. And because I want to bring about, I think most people, more leading with compassion. Like, how are we with time actually, Marion? Are we okay?
Yes, we're okay, but I think soon we should start with a few questions. We've got an amazing questions in the chat box.
All right, then I'll skip this and I'll just send it around. It's just a video about leading with compassion. And I ask you to get to our final exercise, which is answering the question for yourself. What can I apply this to? How can I use these tools to strengthen my own path to justice? And how can I use this to influence others to see their own bias? And I think after 2 minutes of people just writing that down, we can open for questions. All right, so to invite people to also share in a more visualized way, as we go into also questions, I invite you to share on the Menti using the code 19662 to the question, what can I do to strengthen my own path to justice?
Yetan?
Yeah.
I just want to ask, what is this menti.com?
Well, menti.com is just like a visualization tool. So when you type in questions, they show up like you're seeing them now on the screen. So it makes it a bit easier to see many, many answers at a time. That's why I like to use it. Uses compassion, practice in moments of discomfort, practice compassion, having profound conversations. Wonderful. Be friendly to yourself in difficult times. Constantly ask, what can I do to be of service? I must acknowledge that bias exists in my thinking. Sometimes simply seeing that it is there reduces its impact.
Amazing. These answers are wonderful. Find my own strength, treat people equally, deep understanding of the situation, realizing that we're all conditioned and this is something that could be changed. We should learn to accept people unconditionally. Wow, this is wonderful. Separating further from the old colonized me into a more compassionate and caring person. And realizing that all of these change and all of these, you know, self-awareness, we can apply it in different areas of our life, you know, our families, societies, businesses, friends, and so on. It's something that it was, that it's kind of, you know, conditioned, no? Huh? What do you think, Yatan? Should we go over to run a few questions that we received in the chat?
Yes, please. And I don't know if it's possible, but we can take like a screenshot of all of the answers on the Menti and then maybe share it with the people who signed up.
Yes.
Because it's really inspiring, and I think it's just beautiful to have this take this first step, and then gives tools to really talk about a lot of things and resolve the unresolved. But yes, let's go to questions, Natalie.
Nat, could you help us with the screenshots, please, so we then can share it with everybody here. So from Vinita Kerr, why does this happen? Why does this bias or this kind of race segmentation actually happen? What's the process behind it?
Yeah, I mean the that's a big question. I mean, the it has happened in the past because it was a means of dominating in colonization. So making one person, white-looking person mostly, be above others, served very well for dominating because it became part of an education that saw white people as like the masters or the bosses. And it's not always white people, mostly this, but it was a tool of colonization. So just as like a government tool. And then over time, that just became ingrained, right? But I saw some comments there were about it's not natural. So the research shows it is a natural tendency. If we define people who look in another way as other from us, if we do not define them as other from us, which is often not voluntary because it's not something that we are defining, it's something that's happening all around us, then you might not have that discrimination in that in-group, out-group. But it will happen naturally as soon as you define somebody as in your out-group.
Totally. Now we have another question from Barbara Barragan. How can we educate our children in order to dignify any human being? How can we educate in compassion?
That's a really good question. So there is I would say these kind of practices like compassion and loving kindness meditations are really, really powerful because they are all encompassing. And then they're our materials about this, it slips my mind right now, the teacher that did it in the US, who did the experiment with people with blue eyes, kids with blue eyes and kids with brown eyes, and made them kind of create an apartheid in their class based on that. And that was incredibly powerful. For kids, something that really helped me actually when I was in the US is I took a civil rights trip and I visited also the late John Lewis and people who were in first integration. So people who have been really experienced this and talk to them and get them to tell you their story and get people who have been marginalized just by the how they look or whatever it is, what their experience is. So build empathy. I think that's the way.
Asking a question about Ivan Flores, a really good question. How does this kind of exercise produce impact, real impact? He's talking about the compassion exercise. How can we transmute that exercise to, you know, to actual action?
Yeah, really good question, Ivan. So this kind of exercise is something that's an accompanying exercise. It can be a starting, you know, like if you don't know what is, like if you haven't really dealt with this topic or it feels iffy or you feel very guilty about it or something like that, then it's a starting exercise. But it is an exercise which will allow you to keep going even when stuff gets tough, even when there might be biases that you didn't want to see in others or want to see in yourself. It allows you to keep going steady because you can process the contradictions that are happening within yourselves and in others in a more skillful way.
Totally. And another one from Ashok Singh Guleria. How can we raise togetherness in the world? What other techniques apart from this can help us reach this togetherness?
Well, there is, for me, it's this whole practice starts with self-awareness. So seeing where are you, how are you feeling? Can you tell, can you identify it? Because without that, you cannot really be empathetic in a strong, meaningful way. You will get confused or it will become harder. So it all starts with yourself. How can you increase your own self-awareness so you can actually expand your awareness and your compassion onto others? I think that would be my question, my answer to that. And just really exposure. I think it's really about exposure. I don't think I would have overcome many of the biases that I had if I hadn't spoken to people who I had not really been in touch with before. And that's what enabled me to expand my in-group.
I think we have time for two more questions. And the first one would be, if we have negative feelings over others, how can we practice compassion? Like if we take and pretend being friendly, how can we kind of like ignore that positively?
If we have negative feelings towards others?
Yes.
Yeah. So there's another micro practice. We didn't get to do it today, but it's called Impact is Not Intention. So this is like a micro meditation that I also use to consider that whatever another person did, or maybe how I perceive that other person, is not the same as the intention that they had. And this is a whole other meditation practice, but this is something that that can be a starter to improve the communication. And there is actually one important thing, and now that I think of it, which is being compassionate or being skillful in your communication is not always, or is often not even like just being nice. You know, it's how can I express what serves both the best, you know, which can be a boundary, can be, you know, saying no or stopping or calling somebody out or disagreeing, just as much as it can be holding their hand, accompanying them, supporting them. So it's really about what is it that is the most impactful and best thing to do now for both parties. So even if you don't like somebody or you can check, do I actually want to resolve this with this person? If not, then you can decide whether to do anything about it or not. And if you do, then you can start taking steps by looking at their point of view.
Amazing. We're going to go with the last question from Paola Camacho. I have spent the last few years on learning many of the harmful things instilled in me by society, but I'm having a difficult in helping my older family members make the same change. They say that it's because I'm being brainwashed or I don't know the real world. Is there something I could do to make them open their eyes, or are they just a lost cause?
I can relate with that. I would say it's what I would do there is more go for like the Socratic approach, just try to understand the point of view and see if different questions make them see things in a different manner, you know? But also see like what is more important, your relationship with them or their opinion, if they are not causing harm. So that's a very personal decision to make, but my approach would be just asking more questions and seeing if you can find access to how they are thinking, and through that, create a better understanding between the two of you.
Wonderful. And well, I know that I said the last question, but this last question also is very good. This is the last one. How can we encourage people to be compassionate and have compassion for others? And what should people prioritize first in order to more effectively reduce biases in people?
So what should we do to reduce bias? That was the second question, right?
Yes. How can we encourage people to be compassionate and have compassion for others? And what should people prioritize first in order to stay more effectively reduce biases in people?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I work as a, I also like train teams. So the argument for teams is it's just a better working team. It will be, the communication will be better. The engagement in that team, that family, will be higher, and you will just be happier if you practice empathy for the other person, because that being able to go into the point of view of the other person and having an appreciation or compassion for it, even if you don't agree with it, creates safety, and that safety is like the gold of organizational development. If you have a feeling of safety in a group, in a team, in a family, where people can express themselves, that makes it work so much better and have just be also much more fun and much more positive. So I would say maybe go a little bit into the research. I'm also happy to share some on this, but creating the psychological safety is the main reason why it's worthwhile being more compassionate.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Yatan, for this session today. Thanks everyone who joined from all over the world. We had an incredible community here today of people connecting from Mexico, United States, most of European countries, India, Sri Lanka, Philippines, Pakistan, Kenya, Rwanda, India, and many other wonderful countries. We encourage you to stay in touch with our newsletter and follow us on Facebook and Instagram to LUAN Emotional Museum and Global Leaders Program for the latest news. Before closing, I would like to encourage you to join our Art of Mindfulness series. This will be held every Wednesday, same time as today, for the next 10 weeks. During these sessions, together with illustrious industry leaders, we will explore deeply important and rapidly evolving themes. Our next session will be next Wednesday, August 12th, same time as today, with artist and co-creator of Dreamy, Sharona Carney-Cohen, in The Power of Imagination. This dream workshop, we will dive into our sleep and daydreams, our memories, our visions for the future, and where we are in the present day. There will be a guided visualization and opportunity to share and explore dreams with our imagination and to write down our dreams, not only for the year ahead, but the world that we want to create. Please click the link that we shared in the chat to register. Natalia will send the link right now. And thank you so much again. Have a wonderful afternoon. Good evening, the rest of the day. Stay safe, stay healthy, and see you next week.
Thank you, everybody. It's been a pleasure. Thank you, Marion.
Thank you.
Take care.